All of the proposals being considered envision individuals as well as maybe some small businesses buying policies through the exchange. Oftentimes they've ended up with policies that really weren't there for them when they needed it. I want to give you an example. A gentleman named Gary Clausen from Atlantic, Iowa, bought a policy that he and his wife thought were pretty good, was pretty good. Then he got colon cancer and he discovered in the small print that it didn't cover his chemotherapy, which was $200,000, and they will be in medical debt for the rest of their lives. Is there anything in reform that will protect people from accidentally buying these really inadequate plans?
Yes, there is, and in fact, one of the things that there's widespread and bipartisan agreement on is that those kind of policies just shouldn't be out there anymore. They're called in the vernacular mini-med policies, where it looks like it's a good insurance policy, but when you actually read the fine print, a lot of things aren't covered. So those kind of policies won't be offered anymore in this new market. So that's one thing. Secondly, we will not have the lifetime and annual caps that we've had in the past. And so a person like Gary will be really helped by that, because the insurance plan that he purchases won't be able to have those kind of caps anymore. Once we get everyone in the system, that's a big key to it. You can do these insurance market reforms that make sure that pre-existing condition exclusions are repealed, that make sure that people can't have annual and lifetime caps, and really move towards a much stronger marketplace that's better for consumers.
So you're saying that people like Gary, if they go into this healthcare exchange, can't accidentally buy these plans because they simply won't
right.
be for sale.
And the great thing, as I said, is there was bipartisan agreement. Those plans don't work for people.
The president has stressed, and we've all heard it many times, that people who have insurance they like can keep it, mm-hmm. especially people who have insurance through their jobs, which tends to be better insurance. But what about people whose job-based insurance is either terrible or expensive? We just heard the other day from a gentleman from North Dakota who told us that he's got a wife and three kids. His family plan costs him $1,200 a month out of pocket. His employer kicks in $200. He estimates that between his premiums and pretty high copays and deductibles, he's spending 25 to 30% of his family income every year on insurance. It's quite a bit more than he's paying for his mortgage. Does reform offer any help for folks like this?
It does, and we just finished working with the Senate Finance Committee on their version of their bill, and I want to give particular credit to a couple of senators on that committee who worked really hard and doggedly on this very problem. Senator Olympia Snowe and Senator Ron Wyden both were very concerned about what happens to people. They call it horizontal equity. So we're building on the existing employer-based system. For people who are uninsured or in the individual or small group market, they'll have this exchange. But what happens to people who are in the employer-based market, like the man you mentioned, but they're paying such a high percentage of their income on premiums, and maybe the coverage they have just isn't good. So they're going to be allowed, if it exceeds a certain percentage of their income, and I believe the number right now is 12%.
So it would apply to this guy.
Right, it would. So he would be allowed to come over and be in the exchange, and he'd be eligible for subsidies in the exchange if his income, depending on what his income is. And we believe, and the experts who have looked at this also believe, that the coverage there will be less expensive.
Would he still get his $200 a month from his job?
Toward his insurance?
Yes.
Probably not. The employers, we've spent a lot of time talking to the business community there as well, and they say, well, we're putting money in toward a program for him, and so they don't want to have the money come out of their ability to provide it for the other employees for whom it apparently works. So the money won't come from the employer, but it will go, but it will be available in the exchange. And there's still some discussion about whether there would be an employer responsibility beyond that as well.
I'm Nancy Metcalf from Consumer Reports.